What are you hiding, you mastermind? Clearly, there's something we've missed. I get I'm joining late in this franchise's theory stage, but there has to be something. People have already speculated through many of the main characters, and honestly, the entire Ralph side is dead theory is just proof that there's something left to find. Okay, I just gotta take a step back and look at the whole picture. There's gotta be something, right? I mean, no way, you sly dog!
Hello, Internet, and welcome to Gamer Strategies, the show where we've learned it's not just about the lore, but the theorist friends we've made along the way. Today, I wanted to talk about something that may rock the communities as a whole. Something that, upon retrospect, may actively be the key we're looking for. But where do I start? Well, I feel like it's suitable to discuss the core of both games' lore and maybe talk about a few key points that I think a few people have missed.
So, where do we start? Well, for those who don't know, Undertale and Deltarune are made to parallel each other, and in many cases are very similar. But Toby Fox has stated that they aren't connected in terms of time. But ladies and gentlemen, do I have something for you? In each game, we have our player character. In Undertale, it's Frisk, as we find out in the pacifist ending. And we have Chris the Vessel in Deltarune, which somehow we override another save state while we create ours, but it's not ours. I'll get to that later. In Deltarune, we see a lot of the main cast from Undertale in the game, such as Asgore, Toriel, Sans, Alphys, Undyne, Burger Pants, and Monster Kid. Though, let me ask you, do you think the style change is worth it? I mean, they don't really seem like the same character. But a lot of the indirect references, such as Gerson, Papyrus, Azrael, Gaster, and Metaton in spirit, yes, pun semi-intended. Now, these characters are important to note and pay attention to, as this alone is monumental for the story, especially when I make a few connections later. In Undertale, the monsters were oppressed and forced to live underground due to the humans overpowering them in the war and driving many species to near extinction. Now, as a player character, something to note is that we fall long after the first human has fallen into the underground. And Frisk shows signs of being hurt by humanity. I mean, we start off with the bandage and the stick. And when the bandage is applied, it says it's slimy after several uses, meaning Frisk had been hurt multiple times, that or for whatever reason just couldn't separate from the bandage that had healed several injuries, showing a reflective and maybe less sanitary side of the character. But for the sake of the argument, we're just going to say that it shows several injuries. In Pacifist, we see Sans say that in everything we did, even running, we were joyful and had a smile on our face. The key items to Pacifist, as stated before, are the stick and the bandage, which help a lot in the Pacifist run. The stick helping with the dogs in the beginning of the game, and the bandage helping you run from pretty much every fight except for Asgore's fight at the end. Now, on the opposite side of things with Genocide, we see something completely opposite. We are noted as not being human, to skulk around, being creepy and offsetting, and in general, being called weird. Even if you fail the genocide run or decide to stop midway, you'll still get some of these remarks later on, but it is nowhere to be seen in Pacifist. Now, this change prominently begins after you kill Papyrus, where a lot of the monsters run in fear and you are proven to be a threat. Think about it. You don't encounter a vast majority of the monsters you would normally meet in a neutral or pacifist run, and pretty much all of them go into hiding in fear of you once you kill Papyrus. And that's it. News travels, and there's no escaping from the reputation you've started to build. Even in some of the random encounters, a lot of the dialogue shifts into a more vengeful or targeting dialogue, and in some cases, monsters actively want you dead. Now, in Deltarune, monsters were never trapped. There was no war, but we also don't see as much on humans. They're talked about, but it seems as there's a fine line in the communities that just doesn't get crossed. We play as Chris, the adopted child of the Dreamer family, who one day, after being sent to get some replacement chalk with the school bully and almost dying to the bully's hands, falls into the Darklands. In the Light World, we start again with a bandage and a pencil, which I guess is a stick, but we can argue details later, as again, this is an interesting point to bring up, as both Kara and Chris have a very similar relationship within the Dreamer family. Now, in Deltarune, we don't get many paths to choose, as Deltarune seems to tell us constantly that our choices just don't matter. Though we do get Snowgrave, which would be a stand-in for genocide, with the potential for one character being dead in Chapter 3, due to our choices. But we didn't even get to pick our name or the character design that we've chosen for the character, which makes you wonder how this fits in with Undertale. Frisk! But what about being called weird, you ask? Well, I had first seen and heard about weird having a negative connotation from Deltarune theories, and where I saw it appearing almost everywhere in the genocide route, I knew that it had some form of connection. The more I thought about it, the tighter the connection between the games got. So exactly what is this theory, you might be asking? Well, in this video, I'll be trying to create a timeline for Undertale, given no one has done this for both games yet. And this will be taking into consideration how this will play out. So first off, I wanted to work off of the raw story and what we know to be canon. So we need a timeline where Alphys and Undying never really met, and that would be genocide slash neutral. But we also need a route where Asgore survives and Azrael is fully revived, which would be pacifist, but at the same time we need to keep the character behavior from genocide, as well as it being within the time frame of the first fallen human. And I understand what you're saying. This seems to disprove everything that I'm trying to achieve, just in one small idea and an explanation of what we're looking for. And it just means the games are similar, right? Well, what if I told you that they are connected and are part of the same timeline? Allow me to explain. First, what parallels do we have at face value? Well, for starters, the non-player characters, Asgore and Toriel, are slash were in the same relationships, broken up due to Asgore's vengeful spirit claiming the life of someone for killing someone he cared about. Azrael is not accounted for in Deltarune and is dead in Undertale. Undying is serving the community as a watching guard. Benita Neo's body isn't Deltarune, but is unfinished and is puppeted externally and is used by Spanton. Gerson is dead in Deltarune, but Shalmis is parallel, being a member of the King's Court and an advisor, and in Deltarune, he took Azrael's place as being what drives Asgore to kill. Rule's card is obviously a stand-in for Papyrus being a puzzle-loving jokester. Both Lantern and Ralsei are a stand-in for Flowey slash Azrael. Spamton makes me think of Papyrus and Muffet. Muffet in Undertale, they run a very scam-like business. And for the connection with Papyrus, it's because he's trying to be the best at what he does. Jevil seems to be a brazen representation of Sans. Where Sans is a judge and Jevil is judged, he does have key insights as to what Chris is going on, similar to Sans. Now, something I didn't know previously is that Spamton and Papyrus also do this in their respective games. The King of Spades in the Darklands, I feel, is more in line with Asgore and is very similarly stereotyped. The narrator, or the man behind the tree, is commonly accepted to be Gaster. And I'll leave this intentionally vague and explain why, as this will be important later. The Amalgamates and the Amalgamate Graves are kind of easy to point out what the connection is. The Amalgamates, or at least the bad memories, are considered to have something to do with Gaster. And the connection between the Graves and the Amalgamates leaves one unaccounted for. I'll give you a few seconds to guess exactly which character is missing from that lineup. Haven't guessed it yet? Well, I'll tell you. It's Flowey. Allow me to explain. Amalgamates are several entities that have fused together through a DT injection, and it involves injecting a monster or another living being with determination. In Undertale, the human souls are more fluid and contain determination, while the monsters are magic-based, making them more like dust. Now, I don't get how no one has called this out yet, but they wanted to go from testing the DT injection on living things, so Alphys decided to test it on a flower, which is plant life, which also just so happened to have the dead prince's dust on it, which reanimated the prince but didn't cause them to have as many negative effects or the more loquacious form as many of the other amalgamates did. This is because Azrael didn't have the full body that could have been overwhelmed by determination as the other monsters did, requiring more matter to stabilize them. Think of it like dissolving salt in water or putting water on salt. If you add more, eventually you'll see salt building up at the bottom of the water. And that's what happened with the Amalgamates. When the DT injection was applied to the monsters, they needed more matter to stabilize their form, which is why we find them in the condition that they are in. But what does this have to do with Azrael, aka Flowey? Well, he is an Amalgamate, just not as negatively affected because the flower was able to handle more of the DT, and the dust kind of just infused with the flower. But on a greater note, we've seen empty plots just large enough for a body in between the massive graves, and there is one person who's only particularly unaccounted for that we hear oh so much about, this being Azrael. And while going through Tech City, we actually see search history on the computer for two different things: how to make a jello knife, and when the summer vacation for the college starts. We also know that the red horns and the scarf that Chris had vanished at some point. And the theory is as follows. Chris is a known prankster, and Azrael saw Chris leave one night and possibly having the jello knife. Wait a minute. Jello knife. Jevil's knife. You've got to be kidding me. Come on. Okay, sorry, it's just a bit, but how have we missed saying, oh, right, Ezra follows Chris, accidents happen. Likely Chris unintentionally killed Azrael. Being so caught up in the moment, Chris being afraid, took Azrael's soul, leaving the cloak, scarf, and horns in the closet, which then becomes a central fountain later on. As we know, only those with determination can open the dark fountains, which contain fluid matter. Think like a water fountain, which not only opens a gate to this other world, but also fuses the dust from Azrael with the clothing, also giving him life. Though Chris has been learning about magic and is now able to open fountains, so maybe in desperation he opened the fountain and left as soon as he could, taking part of Azrael with him, and the name of the character Ralsei shows how mixed up things are. Okay, before I continue to the next part of the video, I want to give huge credit to Jaro Jaro, as he is the one who first posted the Ralsei as Azrael theory, as well as the Dark Secrets of Deltarune story. But before this is done, I have a new theory I would like to pose that will make a lot of sense. Check out Jaro's video on it, as I didn't cover everything he covered in his video. Well, let's get back to it. So, where am I going with this? Well, there are so many different connections that tie into each story being a parallel, but there is one thing that no one seems to have called out. And the key has been in our faces the entire time. And what is it? What is broken in striving to be whole in each game? We've strived to find out who we are as the player character, putting ourselves in their shoes. The character in question not speaking for themselves nor acting on their own accord. But this isn't all Flowey striving to complete his unfinished mission and to regain his life as it once was, now an amalgamate, a completely mixed mess, as well as completely scattered as his body is dispersed through the world of Undertale and separated in Deltarune between two beings in Deltarune. Sound familiar? Well, I think it should, as I feel like this ties into W.D. Gaster, the one shattered through space and time. Possibly the first amalgamate, but due to the concentration of DT, is able to create physical forms just not their own. We find proof of this even being possible as Undying, the Undying, is able to not only survive a fatal blow, but completely enhance their physical abilities. Sands and Papyrus? This may come as a shock, but I've been talking with people in the community for quite some time now about this, and if you look at their skulls, each one has attributes similar to that of Gaster. Papyrus's is taller, more profile, and the eye sockets better match that of what we see in the Mystery Man sprite. Whereas Sansa's smile and the rounded skull work really well, and when you combine the two, you get WD Gaster's. But why specifically call out Gaster, you say? He has seen it all. he knows about the alternate universes, and keep this in mind, this is going to be huge in a few seconds. Now, upon looking it up, there's only one thing that is a recurring theme, and that is Gaster. The man that fell into his own creation, he is present. And so we see Santa Papyrus pretty much unchanged across both Deltarune and Undertale, and even in most AUs. But think about it. How do we know that Undertale and Deltarune are the original universe? I think Gaster is a sign of something larger, folks. I would like to present you with the Reality Zero theory. What do I mean by this? Well, let me first off go over and talk about Wingdings. They're considered the Dingbat font. And if you think about it, some dude being a klutz and falling into their own creation named WD Gaster, which is a combination of the Wingding and Aster font being used as the sign that something is at play here. And as insane as it sounds, Gaster is the only one with this font, and it is pretty much confirmed it's him. I think he did more than shatter himself. He shattered reality, and in the process destroyed his world, leaving us zero hints as to what was going on. He is attempting to show himself in a way that would reveal the big issues to those of higher power, the player, modders, developers, to fix his mess. Each reality showing us what really happened. And this truly is his story. With the information provided thus far, I think I have the story. Gaster was adopted by a family of power and prestige, and they helped him try to be his best, but ultimately he fell short of their unrealistic expectations and wanted to go out and make a life for himself. Reluctant and resisting the choice, his parents made him work for it, to prove that he could make it on his own and make the world a better place, which he does in many cases. Thoughts of being a pawn in someone else's game bugged him greatly. Being irrelevant to the world scared him, and in the end, was he just a character in someone else's story? He hated the very thought, so he began to study quantum physics, multiversal theory, and many different sciences in hopes of disproving this. Over time, his heart hardened until he realized he was losing himself. He no longer felt passion for his work, the determination to push forward consuming all he was. Eventually, during one of his tests, he accidentally kills his brother and regrets it, and because of this, begins to study life, going as far as creating a machine that seemed to have a soul, having lifelike personality. But it wasn't enough for him. He found a way to store and preserve the life essence of a person, allowing them to live on and granting immortality to those of power as long as they didn't have a child, sharing part of the remaining essence. I'll just start calling it DT, as this is a connection to the story. As he was working on a machine that can alter time, he connected it to the DT extractor, which ended up creating a machine that can alter reality. As he continued his studies, he'd notice over time, gateways would appear over the world, having a bizarre energy readings, as that would lead to alternate realities, most of which were near identical, but would have slight differences. Like he went to a specific class in one reality, but in the other one would have gone to a different class. Or the schedule would be swapped. One day, he wasn't thinking, and while the machine was active, he reached across the gap in the exposed quantum core and fell in, overloading the system with raw determination, causing it to shatter reality into millions of pieces, even creating new forms of life. All the while, he watched in horror at what these worlds centered around his life would unfold to be. Desperate to fix this mess, he would implant thoughts into the back of his own head in each world and attempt to push forward research in order to unify the realities, but to no avail. Drifting further and further into darkness and obscurity, knowing full well that we are looking into his life like a game, treating fragments of his story as a joke, so he fights back, making us really think about what we're doing, hoping we will see. So with all that being said, what does this have to do with the player character, whether it be Frisk or Chris? Well, he was hoping to go over and fix the environments that advanced the studies, making it easier for others to continue the work and easily connect the dots trying to fix the mess. But the vessel he made to do so kept getting taken down and overwritten. And in some cases, other members of reality are to blame, and sometimes it's just the higher power, those who can completely control the world and override his desire. Why do I bring this up? Well, in Chris's case, it changes the entirety of the dynamics between the worlds. Gaster wants people to know of the fountains, and so he opened the first dark fountain. But when we try to enter the reality, we intercept someone's work, taking full control, but at the same time, Chris is still witnessing all of this and is trying to fix the mess, which is what Gaster wants, but can no longer directly do as he lost the ability to speak with Chris. Now, Kara is considered to be the second narrator of Deltarune. This also being said, Kara would be the representation of the intrusive thoughts that would plague Gaster. This also being seen as a split personality, which is both destructive and chaotic. Leaving us with Chris, right? Wrong. As I said, if Chris opened the Dark Fountain trying to save Azrael or hide the fact that he died, he could have fused with Azrael when in the Dark World. I mean, our soul is connected to everyone else and vice versa when in the Dark World, meaning Azrael could have opened the Dark Fountain in the house because he wanted to speak with Toriel again. Kind of creepy, but would make sense. Which means the knight could also be Chris, or rather Azrael in Chris's body. Meaning that Chris needs to get help from family and friends to get this fixed, and Azrael as a whole. And Susie will be one of the ones who ultimately need to help fix this mess in Deltarune. Proof of this could simply be the end of Chapter 2. So exactly what is this timeline? Well, the clock starts the moment Gaster falls into his creation, which in Undertale would have been after the war, which was just reality playing catch-up, filling in the gaps, or rather, in Undertale, the reality starts after Kara's death, which could be backed by Deltarune having a very similar situation being paralleled with the Azrael being dead theory. So how do I go about aligning the time frame to better match both games' time frames? Well, let's take a look at what we know about some of the characters' ages, and more specifically, how time plays out between the stories. In Undertale, it is actually uncertain as to when the game starts. The opening scene is said to be Kara, not the player. And when it is speculated that after the death of Azrael is a few hundred years, 100 being the shortest wait speculated, each of the previous humans having a similar choices to that of the player, and some actively being murderous. Case in point, the Dusty Tutu, and the only other times you see anything referenced to as being Dusty is when monsters had died and the burial ritual had taken place, putting the dust of the monsters on their favorite things to keep them alive in memory. In Undertale, we see the concept of boss monsters, and even how magic works. But where are they in Deltarune? Next to nowhere. Magic is more religious rather than a part of the monster's very being. There is zero reference to the boss monsters, them even being immortal. So if they still age, what does this mean for the story? Well, if we also take in the fact that they can be thousands of years old with the immortality principle in mind, then what if we remove it? They may only be able to live a few hundred years, if even over 100. So think about it like this. The player character is obviously older in Deltarune rather than in Undertale, and we even see Asgore and Toriel who look exactly the same. So to think that they are roughly around the same age between games is a huge thing to note, that at this age, they lost one or both of their kids, especially since they don't age in Undertale. This makes sense, especially since Sans tells Asgore to go talk to his plants. The one thing that is a cornerstone of Undertale being referenced, and no one even batted an eye. Sorry, I couldn't help but point that out, especially after bringing up the connection between both games' incidents having a huge factor in both stories, even if one doesn't mention it as much yet. What does this one reference from Sans of all characters who is known to take shortcuts and has an odd connection to physics and non-Euclidean spaces, like his room or the basket in the shop, give us? It gives us a decent way to ground the story between worlds, as Rousey stands in for Flowey, and in almost every aspect, including role in the Dark World, as he is the prince of this world. But what about story progression? Well, here's where things get interesting. Spamton mirrors Metaton's fight, both regular and Neo, and Jevil mirrors Undying, both normal and Undying the Undying. Even down to the music and sound choices, when you first see Spam to Neo, it sounds like the opening to Metal Crusher. And in the main track, sounds very similar to Death by Glamour, while Jevil's fight is very similar to both Spear of Justice and Fight Against a True Hero, in both pacing and times. But also listen to the instruments, the chord progression. Now, if you also note the order of the fights, Jevil's mirroring Undying before Metaton makes sense. We also see a more waterfall-styled environment as we navigate the Dark World and even through the fight with the King. Also note that the suit used in Chapter 1 was Spades, and in the second chapter, which would be Hotlands, we see more preference to the use of diamonds. And I feel like near the end of Deltarune as a whole, we might end with Hearts. But that is distracting from the main point, as the next secret boss might as well be Asgore or Omega Flowey, as in this case, it's a TV that we see. After this, we'll cycle back to the beginning of Undertale and get three more boss fights, maybe even including Sans himself. And hey, maybe he won't use his strongest attack first. All this being said, we won't know for sure until Chapter 3 releases, confirming our thoughts and theories on the situation. Whether it being the multi-soul theory being confirmed as the player Gaster and Chris, or Chris Azrael and the player, whether Mike is the TV, or who Chris really parallels, down to even who the Roaring Knight is, and confirms or denies our thoughts and theories on Deltarune and Undertale as a whole, whether it be the multi-soul theory being Chris Gaster and the player, or Azrael the player and Chris, Mike being the TV, who Chris really parallels, or even the Roaring Knight. But one thing is for certain, we're not done theorizing. And I will try to cover these theories in later videos. Wait a minute, hold it. There's something I failed to mention. I want you to note exact parallels here. Metamorphosis, Jevil, Genocide, Undying, the Undying, Neo, Spamton, Metaton. But yet, Chapter 3 is specifically started with a TV. Not unlike a specific Photoshop boss. Chapter 1 is the neutral route, while Chapters 4 through 6 might be more reminiscent of the Genocide runs, as the only hint towards Genocide route is Snowgrave in Chapter 1. Think like Snowden, which tends to be the area that is a true make it or break it for Genocide route, is if you can't handle Undying, that's the best you can do successfully. So, what is Chapter 3 going to be? Toriel and Undying joining the fight? Maybe we see Rylsay go to call Toriel mom and stop. And Mike will be the stand-in, or even furthermore, maybe isn't Mike, but Azrael's attempt to stay in the Light World, and ends up fighting Chris, or rather us, to prevent us from closing it. Or we have to control the rest of the crew and force Chris to close the fountain. The next three or four chapters may introduce Asgore and Alphys to the Dark World, and maybe Sans tries to stop us, as opening Dark Fountains may destroy the world. The final three chapters would follow True Pacifist, showing us a healing arc, at least for Chris, as everyone learns of what happened and the Roaring Knight shows up. Maybe Asriel in person. Maybe he's trying to bring back December, as well as be able to leave the Dark Lands and function normally. But like Flowey, we see a more cruel and merciless side of him, as Rousey has these traits. And Chapter 10? The fight. The one against the most mysterious character of all, posing as Chris, with the rest of his friends and family trying to have him regain control. And that vessel that we made in Chapter 1? Yeah, we are gonna need it. Now, if this wasn't enough, I would like to point out Toby's use of dual meanings, even down to the prophecy in Undertale where it states, "An angel shall return to the underground and will free monsters, leaving it empty." And as we see in Undertale, the monsters also interpret it as an angel of death, either being Azrael and True Pacifist or Kara and Genocide, the player allowing them to return and hunt the rest of the monsters before moving to the surface to strike back at humanity. This too also applies to Deltarune, and many nuanced things in the series as a whole. In Undertale, we actively see two fight styles, one for Genocide and one for Pacifist and Neutral. This can also be applied to the dual usage of the prophecy in Deltarune, not just Undertale, as Noelle is portrayed as an angel, returning to the Dark World to confront her fears, being an angel in both design and function, as she also, like Rousei, seems to be a form of weaker moral compass. Though as much as I would love to talk about all of this in detail, it will have to be a dedicated video, as I just do not have enough time to draw this on much further, as when I was previously recording this, the original audio that I had made had taken about a week to record, and the script alone took about a month to work out. But for now, please let me know your thoughts on these series in the comments below. And until next time, whether it be a game rant or a memorable moment, this is Mr. Knot Knot signing out. See ya.